I got it.
So I'd like to ask you all to go back with me a bit in time to a period shortly after I was injured. After 3 months of having my head screwed into what's called a halo cast, a stabilizing contraption, kind of out of a Frankenstein movie that helps your neck heal, I was just a few weeks into regaining movement, building my neck strength, and learning how to be mobile again. It was a very early one weekday morning, I think it was actually in late February, and a night nurse on her way out from an all-night shift came in and woke me in her very special, I've been up all night and I'm less than caring right now sort of way. She barked at me, they wanted me to get you up early and tell you to get yourself dressed, and I don't know why. She barked at me as she was leaving to head home. I wasn't exactly your model patient, so I think I sort of deserve this, but nevertheless was a little wondering what she said. She left me no time to respond. I had no idea why she wanted me up. So I did what I knew what I could do best at that point in my life. I fell back asleep into a world where I was dreaming that I wasn't disabled and everything was normal and at peace. A short time later, my physical therapist, who is a large, kind of Grizzly Adams looking guy, burly and happy and rotund, came walking in. He said, didn't they tell you to get up and get dressed? He dropped a set of car keys on my bed and said, I'm not just your physical therapist, I'm the driving instructor, and I think it's about time that you and I get out of the hospital and learn how to drive. I should have listened to what the nurse said and got dressed. Me driving, I could barely move, I could barely sit up, touch my toes, get out of bed, and here I was about to get behind the wheel of a car again. The very idea of getting behind the wheel gave me motivation. It changed my attitude and gave me new hope. I knew I was never going to walk again, but that morning I knew that there were still things that I was going to be able to do. Driving would give me the hope that I needed to get back into my life. Behind the wheel, I could still roll down the window. I could see what's around the corner. I could see the sights, smell what's out there, and be me again. Just hearing those keys jingle triggered something in me that I had thought had been taken just a few months earlier when I broke my neck in the waters off Pensacola Beach. I grabbed the keys, I chased down the physical therapist, we rolled out into the hospital parking lot and I learned how to drive. So fast forward a few months and I'm sitting in a handicapped vehicle conversion center somewhere outside of Boston, and I'm like a kid in the candy store. I'm looking at wheel options, hand controls, steering knobs, fold-out beds, inside carpeting, lifts, all sorts of crazy stuff. I was a car guy, so this was just fantastic to me. When I finished picking out everything for my prescription, I signed the paperwork and reached out my hands to get the keys. The salesperson looked at me and just laughed. He said, you got to be patient, my friend. This van's going to be ready for you, but it's going to be about 3 or 4 months. We have to build this from scratch. At that moment, I was devastated again. I was crushed. I had to wait some more. Things weren't easy. It was like the wheels just fell out from underneath me and all the tires, you know, the air came out. I didn't know what to do. I was just sad all over again. And in those 3 or 4 months, while I waited, things were pretty difficult. I called every single friend I knew, every family member to take me to the mall, to the store, to the movies, to church, to the beach, anywhere I could go. I just wanted to get out. I just needed to get out there and get back into society. That's what I really wanted to do. And it got to the point where every day my parents wondered when they got up where I had gotten off to. Was I pushing somewhere? Did I get a ride? What time was I going to be back? Was I safe? I remember one sunny afternoon, I got up and got dressed and found my way to a beach parking lot about 5 miles from the house. Now in my family, we called them mic sightings. Usually a neighbor would happen to see me a few blocks from the house would call my folks and tell them that, you know, Mike's okay. He hadn't been hit by a car. He's okay. He's just around the tree, just around the corner. Today was different. I was 5 miles away and I got there all on my own. My mom had no idea what to do, and we had this little unwritten rule about, Mom, whatever you do, don't show up and ask if I'm okay and can I get you anything. And be all motherly because you'll kind of ruin my street cred with my friends. She didn't know what to do, so she did what she thought was best. She called the police. Now, the police don't typically go out and just check up on people because their mom tells them to. I wasn't on the most wanted list, and I wasn't a missing person. So they said, call back in a couple, you know, couple days if he's lost, and then we'll send out the forces. So my mom was lost. She found her way out onto the street and found one of those summer officers in training, not really a police officer, but somebody who thought he was. She went up to him and told him that I was a runaway child. And he had to go find me. And by the way, she knew exactly where I was. So next thing you know, the police roll up to me and asked if I was Mike Savicki, the missing child. I was 23 years old. So after we had a little laugh and the police ID'd me and found out I was okay, I rolled home. But that was just one of the many stories that happened before I got my van. Getting my first van was the greatest thing in my life at that point. It was empowering, liberating. It gave me an incredible sense of freedom. It helped me realize that I could still be the person that I was and go all those places that I never thought I'd be able to do, those things that I used to take for granted. So the first few months, all I did was drive and drive and drive and drive. Every friend and every family member that ever gave me a ride somewhere, I paid them back. And I got them good parking, too. My first long trip in my van was for a wheelchair rugby tournament. I was living in Boston at the time. And I loaded up my van and drove my team from Boston through New York City, down the Jersey Turnpike to a gym in Pennsylvania. In hindsight, I think I was the only one naive enough to want to do that drive. Everybody else knew no one ever wants to drive through the city. But for me, it was fantastic. And over the last two decades, my vans have taken me plus racing wheelchairs and tennis wheelchairs and basketball wheelchairs and hand cycles up and down the East Coast and to almost every state in the Union. Just a couple years ago, we cut short a hand cycling trip down North Carolina's Outer Banks because a hurricane was coming and the police and the natural resources officers were having everybody evacuate Hatteras Island. And the only way that I was able to get the van off was to convince the police officers that my full-size elevated van with these really cool-looking tires had four-wheel drive capabilities and the blowing sand and the oncoming surf would be no match for it. So I was able to get off the island. I guess if you play your cards right as a handicapped driver, sometimes you get more than just prime parking. So driving has given me a unique sense of self. It's given me a sense of power, a sense of belonging, and a unique sense of normalcy. And driving is a gift that we can all share. 18 million people across the United States and Canada have mobility issues. 6 million of those are veterans. There are 3 million people like me in wheelchairs. Many don't know that they can still drive, like I didn't know that I could drive. It's our job to educate them. It's our job to make everyone aware. Helping the disabled regain independence is a cause that's very close to me. It's something I've worked for 20 years for, to help promote. I'd like you to walk away from this message thinking about the word educate. That's what our job is. It comes from the root educe, which means to bring forth from within and to bring out potential. I challenge you to educate the people in your communities about what it means to get out and to be mobile, to help build health, self-esteem, and to help give folks like me a life. That's all we want. Thanks, Sam, for the introduction. Thanks, Dave, for inviting me along on this fantastic journey. And thanks to you guys for listening and laughing with me. I'm honored to be the spokesperson for National Mobility Awareness Month, and I'm honored to be with you today. Thank you.